It's ninth season now, but seasoned veterans are still making mistakes you think they would have learned to avoid by now. Luckily for us, watching these common mistakes is a great way to improve on our own game. In this list, we're going to go over the most common and influential mistakes we still see people make. So let's jump right into it. Let's take a look at 5 mistakes you're likely to make in Fortnite right now. And don't worry, we'll be telling you what it takes to improve in each area. Right at the start of each game is where we see our first mistake happen, messing up the initial drop. Having the fastest landing among all the people in an area has some great advantages. For instance, you get to loot sooner. Extra loot time means more items and more material. While it may not seem like much, an extra 5 to 10 seconds of looting can make a world of difference when it's the start of a game. But beyond a bit of extra loot time, the main reason you want a good drop is to secure the drop location. Generally, when players see you have the better landing at a house or building, they'll just let you take it. If they still try to contest, you've got the better landing and can probably find a weapon first. We feel the only exception to this is when landing on a roof for a chest. Gliders are pretty silent at the start of the game, and players who know this use it to their advantage. It's not uncommon for them to land on someone going for a chest to get that pickaxe elimination. To prevent this from happening to you, we recommend entering through a door and going for the floor loot first. Securing a drop location is especially important in highly populated zones like Mega Mall, Neo Tilted, or Pleasant Park. A good drop can be the difference between having to contest somebody and being able to safely open chests and gather loot. So how do you achieve these good drops? Well, it's all in the landing mechanics. In Fortnite, your initial jump from the bus allows you to skydive at incredible speeds. However, once the game senses you've gotten close to an object or terrain, it will automatically pull your glider. Knowing how to utilize this mechanic is what allows for great landings. To take advantage of this, keep these 2 things in mind. First, aim for low elevation. The lower the spot you drop toward is, the later your glider pulls out. This simply means you'll touch the ground sooner, which is what we want when committing to a drop. And second, drop a short distance away from the specific area you want to land. Newer players make this mistake a lot. They'll drop directly above the POI they want to land at and just end up hovering, waiting to land. Instead, you want to aim at the location and deploy your glider at the perfect distance. When done correctly, it leads to faster and more precise landings. Season 9 has introduced a couple of new ways to drop quickly as well. The slipstreams and floating platforms added to the map put you in skydive mode as soon as you enter them. You can potentially shave off a couple of seconds from your landing if utilized properly. Like in previous seasons, ziplines can also allow you to reach the ground faster. Just glide near it, enter the zipline, and then jump off. If you feel like your drop is a little short or needs adjusting, you can use volcano vents to enter skydive mode again. While these mechanics can help you achieve better drops, we recommend not focusing on them too much and instead work on the base mechanics that remain the same from season to season. Trust me, I also wanted to jump right into the more advanced stuff when I first started out, but taking my time with the basics really helped me get battle royales in arena mode. The dropping mechanics in Fortnite are quite intricate and difficult to master. It may take several hundred attempts before players can get a real good feel for fast drops. Messing them up is all part of the learning process, so don't be worried if you botch your landing a few times. Like most FPS, Fortnite players are better off making peaks on the right side. The reasons vary from game to game, but in Fortnite, here are the most important reasons why you don't want to peek on the left-hand side. Your character holds the gun on their right, and in Fortnite, bullets actually come out of the weapon. So if you peek around the left corner of a wall, you have to expose so much more of your body just so you can shoot. If you want to be able to shoot your weapon while showing as little of your body as possible, choosing to strafe and peek towards the right side is the best option. When done correctly, you're going to be hitting your opponent first almost every time. The other reason the right side peeks are better is because of the way the character model is positioned on the screen. The character mostly covers the left side of the screen, especially when you aim down sights. Right side peeks, in this case, will lead to fewer scenarios where you block your vision with your own character model. You can use this to your advantage in close range gunfights. The better direction to strafe and duck is toward the right of your opponent. This way, you're more likely to be covered up on your enemy's screen by their own character model. The most important time to use right side peeking to your advantage has to be with edits. When you replace a wall or floor, usually you go for an edit so you can shoot the person inside. A lot of the time, your opponent will react by pulling out a weapon so they can shoot back. Minimize your chances of being shot here by editing the right side of the piece, whether it be a window or the right side corner of the floor. Be sure you're behind cover while editing, since you still need to pull out a weapon. Once the edit is made and you've pulled out your gun, you can then strafe right and go for the shot. Overcommitting is any case where a player becomes too aggressive for a kill. Situations such as not building between shots, not using cover properly, and dropping off the high ground when you shouldn't. It's a pretty general term, but just know that overcommitting in these scenarios is usually the wrong play, as it puts you in a vulnerable position that may lead to your death. First, let's look at when players stop building and go for the kill. This isn't really a mistake in itself, but can sometimes be a risky play. If you look at any footage of a pro player getting high kill games, you'll see just how often they utilize building to reduce the amount of damage they take. Even just firing one shotgun shot at your opponent and then building can be more effective in the long run than shooting and going for the finish right then and there. Sure, fights tend to be longer when you play in this more defensive manner. However, we'd say the extra time taken to finish fights more than makes up for the amount of damage you can reduce. So try and keep this in mind while fighting. When you get the drop on your opponent, try and get as many shots in as you can. Then, when you see them look in your direction, whip out the builds and find a new angle, either with a ramp peek or a right side wall peek. When going for those peeks from behind cover, being able to show as little of your body as possible is actually a skill that many players don't think of anymore, even when they have the advantage. We've seen so many players over peek and die because of it. If you're shooting around a wall, for instance, peek only the amount you need to be capable of hitting your opponent. Then get back behind the wall, rinse, and repeat. So many players peek and just stand there, waiting to fire their remaining rounds, when they should be going back behind cover in between shots. Now, the absolute biggest mistake of overcommitment we see happens when players give up their height advantage. Too many times a player will think it's better to drop from their high ground just to go for the kill of an enemy. I'm sure we've all seen this done at some point, only to have it not work out. We drop down, can't finish the kill, and all we've done is give up the high ground. Instead, the better thing to do is, well, keep your high ground. With it, you can line up shots using the third-person perspective while not showing yourself. The combat shotgun is great for this. Line up the shot, peek a bit to fire, then duck back behind cover. If you do this well enough, most opponents won't even be able to retaliate. Even when it comes to just spotting a player in the distance and wanting to shoot them, we see plenty of players overcommit. Like, yeah, sure, you spotted a player, but what about the rest of the lobby? Sometimes it can be very risky to immediately start shooting at a player when you haven't taken your surroundings into consideration yet. Next time you play and you want to shoot, try putting up some cover around you first before you open fire. Even just a bit of cover can reduce the chance of you getting hit by a third party. We're 9 seasons in now, and still, more often than not, we see players not reinforcing their builds. More specifically, we're talking about weak ramp rushes and not putting pyramids over floors. Honestly, if you're not reinforcing your builds, especially your ramp rushes, you're putting yourself at a big disadvantage. There's a lot of unexpected ways this can help. Let's say you're doing a ramp rush. One ramp would get shot out by an assault rifle pretty quickly. The shooter will be left with plenty of ammo as well. But what if you put down more pieces to reinforce the ramp? Putting a wall and floor there means there's another piece your opponent has to destroy in order to cause the ramp to collapse. The second piece has more time to build health as well, meaning it's going to take time and more bullets to shoot out. Now the shooter has even fewer rounds remaining. You can even go beyond this with a more powerful ramping techniques. This includes the double floor wall ramp or the triple layer ramp rush. Opponents will struggle to shoot these ramps down. If they try to take it down, capitalize on this by shooting at them. There's a good chance you will get the kill before your ramp even gets shot down. A lot of the time, enemies won't attempt to take it down because they're intimidated by the sheer amount of build. And even if they do manage to shoot you down, their weapon is probably close to being out of ammo at that point. This situation allows you to take over as the shooter. The other reinforcement technique we need to bring up is pyramids over floors. We can't stress enough how important this is. Whether you're carpeting in the sky or turtling in a 1x1, putting a pyramid over your floor piece is far too efficient and useful to not be done. For turtling, make sure you put the pyramid over your floor before an opponent does. If you do, they'll have another layer of protection they need to bust through. Then they might choose to go for one of your walls instead, giving you the opportunity to edit out the top and get high ground control. We won't be going over the specifics of how to perform these ramp rushes. We'll save that for another video. Just keep in mind that they take practice to perform well. If you'd like to learn how to do them perfectly, we recommend checking out our building courses over at proguides.com. Combine that with a solid creative session, and we believe any player can learn to perform these game-changing techniques. I mean, it's really made a difference for me personally. Here are a few more extra things to keep in mind when it comes to reinforcing builds. Know that splodes can destroy these ramps easily. Your opponent only needs one rocket or grenade to take them down. Also, you obviously end up using more material when reinforcing builds, so you always need to keep the amount of material you have in the back of your mind while playing. Sometimes you just don't have that much material. That's just how some matches can be. Often in these low mat situations, you need to build as little as possible to make sure you'll be able to build later on. Finding and getting used to the right balance is key here. Prior to Season 5, there used to be plenty of good reasons to build with wood. It was obviously the easiest material to farm, and still is. But also, its starting HP was higher, and it would reach max HP the quickest. Eventually, this was changed. Wood's health no longer beats brick or steel. I mean, makes sense. So what's the best material type to use now? Well, let's list them by strength. Metal, brick, and then wood. But really, choosing the right type can depend a lot on the situation. In a build fight, your opponents will be shooting at your build in an attempt to knock you down and land some shots. To get the most protection possible, use steel or brick during build battles. It's also a good idea to pay attention to what material your opponent is using and try not to use the same kind as them. If they aren't using the same type as you, you'll more easily be able to replenish your mats after you eliminate them. For traversing the map as well as late game rotations, wood can be a good choice since you're mostly using it to move around and not as cover. You generally want to save brick for situations where you need them as cover. Of course, you want to do the same thing with metal. When fully built, metal is the only material that isn't easily see-through. This means opponents will have a much tougher time figuring out where you're positioned inside a metal base as opposed to wood or brick. Not only that, but the max health on metal walls is over 3 times that of wood, making people in the lobby much less inclined to spam your walls. When setting up a base or 1x1, you should always try and use metal when you can. And there you have it, 5 common mistakes even pros make in Fortnite and how to fix them. We know you'll be able to apply most of it to your own gameplay. To learn even more, be sure to check out our Fortnite courses over at ProGuides.com. With over 20 courses available, you'll be able to find much more in-depth information when it comes to the topics we've discussed today. If we've been helpful, please feel free to toss us a subscription and like the video.